mountains, everything will crumble. The entire galaxy, entire world, solar system, everything will crumble and everything will be destroyed. Every single thing will be all destroyed. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, Ummati, Ummati. The people of Jahannam will be thrown into the fire of Jahannam on their stomachs. They will be dragged on their faces and they will be thrown into the fire of Jahannam. Well, they will abide there forever. They will be there forever and ever and ever.
No. Rotate the tripod. Rotate the tripod. Please don't rotate the phone.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى ألم يجدك يتيما ووجدك ضالا ووجدك عائلا فأغنى فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنحر وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث.
Take that mic. No. This one. The head. Yeah.
It's okay. We're here. I got it. Welcome to our youth program. We appreciate everyone for coming here today despite the harsh weather and being persistent with these programs, which happen only once a month. May Allah bless you all and bless you in this world and the next life. So in regards to this program, how it'll be set up, the first 30 to 40 minutes of this program will be a guest speaker giving our speech, followed by Q&A, and then followed by a match of Kahoot, and then we will conclude this program with dinner. As for the Q&A, there are multiple ways of getting your questions in. The first way is by sending the email, that's from the email posted on the wall. The second is by writing on paper and sending it. The third way is by sending a direct message to the Instagram page called Unified Ummah. The fifth way is you can message Unified Ummah on the Facebook page, all of which are anonymous. Lastly, you can raise your hand directly and ask your question. And after the Q&A, I request everyone to stay till the end because there will be a Kahoot match, which the winner will receive a prize at the very end. After that, the food will be served downstairs, inshallah. We request everyone to stay with us, inshallah. Without further delay, I would like to quickly introduce our guest speaker. Moulana Jamil is a graduate of Darul, Uloom, New York, and now is a teacher at Hillside Islamic Center, and has taken out the time on his busy schedule to be with us here today. So may Allah accept from Moulana Jamil, and may Allah bless him as well, ameen. I would like to now request Moulana Jamil to enlighten us with his speech, inshallah.
إن الحمد لله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا مولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين عبده ورسوله فقد قال الله تعالى في كتابه العزيز اقترب للناس حسابهم وهم في غفلة معرضون وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس أحد يحاسب به يوم القيامة إلا هلك وقالت عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها أوليس يقول الله تعالى فسوف يحاسب حسابا يسيرا وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ذلك العرض ولكن من نوقش في حسابه فقد هلك أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العزيز الحكيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي أما بعد الحمد لله Through the blessing of Allah, my brothers, elders, and sisters, and youngsters, we are here gathered today. Despite the severe weather, we are in the masjid and we are in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are in the masjid, the best place in the eyes of Allah. Allah Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that ahabbul biladi lillahi masajiduha, that the best places in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the earth, from the cities and the countries and the continents, Allah says, that the best places to him are the masajid. Because this is where the remembrance of Allah Rabbul Alameen goes on. When we step foot into the masajid and we observe all the adab and the etiquettes, when we step inside, we put our shoes down, we enter with the right foot and we say the dua, Allahumma ftahli abwaab rahmatik. Some of these du'as, as youngsters, we should know what we are saying. Allahumma ftahli abwaab rahmatik. Oh Allah, open for me the doors of your mercy. The doors of mercy is the masjid. How do we attain from Allah's rahmat and Allah's infinite mercy? When we come to the masjid, we are saved from all types of sin. And it is up to us to hold up the sanctity of the masjid. The masajid are holy places, places where the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala go on. This is why it is important that we as Muslims, especially as youngsters, alhamdulillah, it is a great sight to see so many of you here today. You should feel happy that you are in this place and that you are not somewhere else where you would be wasting your time. We came into the masjid today, we gave a few hours out of our time to come here to the house of Allah Rabbul Alameen. Some of us may have come only for the food, some of us have came because our parents are forcing us, others have came because our friends are here, and others are here just because they have nothing else to do. But whatever reason that we have come, despite that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will still write you from, write us from amongst the dhakireen, those people who are remembering Allah Rabbul Alameen. This is the infinite mercy of Allah. This is why when we say, Allahumma ftahli abwaaba rahmatik, Ya Allah, open for me the doors of your mercy. No matter what intention I have come with, if I was forced to come or I came on my own, Allah Rabbul Alameen still writes you from amongst the dhakireen, those people that are remembering Allah Rabbul Alameen. So you should feel happy and you should feel gratitude, you should feel grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He's giving you this opportunity. Now it is upon you for you to hold up the sanctity of the holy masjid and also to hold up remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why just before we get into the talk, just a short reminder for all of us. Because of all the technology and all the fitna, all the different things that are out today, many of us, we come into the masjid and the sanctity of the masjid is gone. Because when we come inside, during the time of the Sahaba, they will leave the dunya behind. Us today has become a little bit different than when we come inside, we are talking about the dunya, and as we are walking out, we are talking about the dunya. So it is important, just a small reminder for all of us, that when we come inside the masjid, we should realize and understand, this is not my friend's house. This is not my brother's house. This is not my sister's house. This is not my mom's house. This is my Rabb's house, my creator. This is his house that I am coming inside of. And because I'm coming inside of this house, I need to act accordingly. When you go to a guest's house, you do not run around, you don't do whatever you want, you don't say whatever you want. So similarly, when we come to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we should hold up the sanctity, the holiness of the masjid. When we do this, then when we come here, we will feel a sense of ease. Yes, we can come, we can communicate, we can relax and talk, but we should not use this time in the masjid to waste. Not talk about the things of the dunya. Not use our cell phones and to show our friends the videos and things that are online. Save that for another time. We did not sacrifice our time spending walking to the masjid, coming inside, sitting down, all of this just to come so I can talk about the dunya. We could have done that at our homes. We could have stayed home and done that. So I urge all of us, brothers, elders, youngsters, and everyone, to give our full attention to what is being said. Ali radiallahu ta'ala, he used to say, "Unzur ila ma qil, wa la tanzur ila man qal." That look towards what is being said. And alhamdulillah, today's topic is one of the topics the youth love to listen about. Qiyamah, what is going to happen, and the signs of. Alhamdulillah, the program before, the signs of Qiyamah have already been discussed. So I'm hoping everyone, inshallah, can give their full attention to what is being discussed. And do not look at who is the speaker, whether it is what is being said is appealing, or whether if he's making jokes, whether the speaker is interesting or not, if he's monotonous, whatever. Because when the kalam of Allah and the kalam of His Rasul, when the words of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is being mentioned by anyone, any Muslim, we should listen attentively. Because it is as if Allah and His Messenger are speaking to us. So let us all give our attention completely, and let us all focus and be attentive to whatever is being said. And inshallah, we will all take benefit. Inshallah, it will increase us in our knowledge of Deen and Islam. So that being said, alhamdulillah, let's get into today's topic. A lot of us, we like to discuss about this, and we hear about this, and this is one of the articles of our faith. We know that as Muslims, there are different, we all have to have Iman. We all have to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to believe faith upon Allah. And from Iman, there are certain things that we have to believe. And we know, starting it comes with Amantu billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi. Right, all of these things we all have to believe in. And Allah, in His books, in His angels, in His messengers. And amongst those things that we all have to believe in is on the Day of Judgment. All of us, we have to believe in Yawm al-Qiyamah, that there will be a last day. There will be a last day, the Yawm al-Yaqum al-Hisab, that where the Hisab will be taking place, the accountancy will be taking place. Every single one of us will go through Hisab. So this is Qiyamah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was probably mentioned before, but let's just reiterate it again. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came, he said, Ana wasa'a hatain, and he put his fingers together, that me in the final hour is like this. And he put his fingers together, meaning that the time from Qiyamah, it is so close, it is as if the gap between the index finger and the middle finger, the amount of gap there is when you put them together, this is how much time is left until Qiyamah will happen. And with all the things that are happening around us, all of the movements and all of the things that are happening, all of the different fitan, all the trials and different things, wars and fighting and bloodshed, all of these things that are happening today around us, these are all signs for us. Almost all of the signs of Qiyamah are here. So we as Muslims, we know when the sign is coming. When we know a test is coming, we are prepared. We start preparing. We start studying. So we can do the best that we can. So my brothers and elders and sisters, it is important that we try our best. We see the signs are manifesting before our eyes. The signs are manifesting. We should not be ghafil. We should not be heedless from it. For Allah in the Quran, He mentions, اِقْتَرَبَ لِلنَّاسِ حِسَابُهُمْ, that the time for reckoning is coming. That the reckoning, the final hour is coming for the people. But وَهُمْ فِي غَفْلَةٍ مُعْرِضُونَ, but they are turning away from it. They are not paying attention to the signs. They don't care about the signs. They don't care that Qiyamah is coming. My brothers, elders and sisters and youngsters, it is important that we try our best to take heed from all the things that we are seeing before us. So now to delve into today's topic about what will happen after Qiyamah. Yes, all the signs come forth. Ya'juj, Ma'juj, Isa alayhi salam, Mahdi, Dajjal, all of this happens. And all of these things transpire. What happens after that? We understand that after Isa alayhi salatu wasalam kills the Dajjal, that there will be peace upon earth. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he will get married and he will have children and he will live on this dunya, he will live on this earth. Then after that, he will pass away, and once again the dunya will start to slowly deteriorate. And the dunya will go back, the world, everything will go back, and all the fitna and all the calamities and all the troubles will start to happen again. And it will slowly, year after year after year after year, it will start to get worse and worse and worse. Then finally, when the fitna is so much, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send the wind. The rih, the wind will come and it will obliterate and it will kill all of the Muslims. All of the believers on this world that are here, they will all die. Then finally, when this dunya, when there is nobody left on this earth, dunya on this earth, and there's not a single person, a single Muslim who is left to say, utter the words, Allah, Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell Israfil alayhi salatu wa salam to blow the horn. Israfil alayhi salatu wa salam will tell Israfil alayhi salam to blow the horn, and he will blow. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ فَصَّعِقَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell all of the people. In the Quran, as-sur means the trumpet. It was asked, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Masur, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he explained to them, what is the trumpet? What is it? He said, Al-Qarq, meaning it's like a horn. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tried to explain to the Sahaba what it was, and Rasulullah told them, anytime as-sur is the horn, the angel Israfil alayhi salatu wa salam, who has the horn ready to blow since his creation, since the time he was ready and he was created and he was given his task to blow the horn when Allah tells him. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions in the hadith when Aisha radiallahu anha tells Rasulullah, why aren't you having a good time? Why do you look distressed? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he responded by saying, how can I be happy? How can I be joyful? How can I rest when I know the one who has the horn, who was created to blow the horn, has set his eyes firm and he has set his eyes set upon the horn, ready to blow it. He has the horn right on his mouth, ready to blow the horn, and his eyesight fixed upon the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not even blinking, afraid that if he blinks, he will miss the amr, the hukum of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to blow the horn. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell Angel Israfil alayhi salatu wa salam that he will tell him to blow the horn. Israfil alayhi salam will blow the horn, and when the horn is blown, every single creation, every single makhluk of Allah, all the creation of Allah will be destroyed. All the human beings, everything will fall. Everyone will fall and they will die flat. And this will be a screeching sound. This sound will continue to blow until every single person left on this earth dies. Everything will be destroyed. Except illa man sha Allah. Except for whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. And from this ayat, the Mufassireen, the people of the Quran, they have translated this to mean illa man sha Allah, to mean those people. I'm sorry, not those people, but the malaika. Except there will be some that will still be alive whom Allah will give them death later. Like the angel of Israfil himself and the angel Jibreel, angel Malakul Maut. They will still be alive, and later on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell them, will take their lives, each of them, to such an extent there will be none alive after that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will tell the angel Israfil, when there is none left on this earth to utter Allah, Allah, Allah will destroy this earth. Allah will destroy everything. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran mentions, when it's blown in the first time, وَحُمِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ وَالْجِبَالُ فَدُكَّتَ دَكَّةً وَاحِدًا, that the mountains, everything will crumble. The entire galaxy, entire world, solar system, everything will crumble and everything will be destroyed. Every single thing will be all destroyed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing the second phase. When all of these things are being destroyed, Allah is preparing the second phase of the Qiyamah to begin. And that is known as Al-Mahshar. So going back to the first thing, when the first horn is blown, in the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, مَا بَيْنَ نَفْخَتَيْنِ أَرْبَعُونَ. Abu Huraira, he is narrating this hadith that he heard from the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, that he's saying, مَا بَيْنَ نَفْخَتَيْنِ أَرْبَعُونَ, that the amount of time which is between the two blowings of the horn, we know, we believe that the horn will be blown twice. We believe that the horn, the trumpet, Asur, will be blown twice. The first time, everything will be destroyed. All of the humanity, everyone will be destroyed. Then Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu was saying that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said Arba'un. He just mentioned 40. The companions were asking Abu Hurairah, Arba'una yawman, Arba'una sanatan. So 40 days, 40 years, how long, 40 what? And at each time they asked him, Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, Abayt, I don't know. Rasulullah did not mention what, 40 years, 40 days, 40 months, but he just said Arba'un, he just said 40. So in this, we do not know how long that time will be between the blowing of the two horns. So we know first and foremost that the horn will be blown the first time and everything will be destroyed. All of the things, all the human beings, everyone will be destroyed. And all of the things, all the human bodies, all of those things will decay. The human being will start to decay until it becomes completely nothing, until it turns in. The hadith, Rasulullah mentions that it will become ajabul dhanabi, that it will become, the body will decay, every single body of it will decay until it comes down to the tailbone. Until it comes down to the tiny little tailbone that we have, every single human being, the body will decay. The body will decay and everything will come down until it goes to ajabul dhanabi, that becomes the tailbone. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send out, thumma yunzilu minas sama'i ma'a. Allah Rabbul Alameen, He will send down from the water, He will send down water from the skies. And the sky, the water will nourish this bone until it becomes flesh again, until it becomes a body again. And this will happen to every single person on this earth until everyone is back. The body is back, but the soul is not. Every single person's body will be back after everything is destroyed and after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reconstructing the world. In the hadith it is mentioned that when everyone is raised, everything will be flat. We will all be in a flat land. This is known as Al-Mahshar. This is known as Al-Mahshar, the place of gathering. So when the first trumpet is blown, we understand that everything will be destroyed until that everyone is left until their tailbone. Then Allah, the mountains are being crumbled, the galaxies, everything is coming together until it becomes a flat land. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send down the rain and everyone, that tailbone that we have will sprout up. Every single one of us will sprout up, the tailbone, it will grow like the way plants grow. And slowly flesh, meat, everything will grow on until it becomes a human again. Until that bone becomes turned into that human again. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell Israfil alayhi salatu wa salam to blow the horn again. The Israfil alayhi salatu wa salam, he will blow it again. ثُمَّ نُفِخَ فِيهِ أُخْرَ فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ That Israfil alayhi salam will blow the trumpet again and everyone will be standing. All the souls will be returned back into the bodies. All those bodies that were just formed from that tiny little tailbone, the bodies will be formed and Allah will blow the horn trumpet again and the souls will return back into the body. And every single person's soul will be come back into the body and we will all be in Hashar. We will all be in the Mahshar, the place of gathering. And in this place, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to Aisha in the hadith, we will be hufatan uratan, that we will be barefoot and every single one of us will be naked. Aisha radiallahu anha, she says that won't people be looking at one another? All of us will be naked on that day. Won't all of us be looking at each other? So then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Al-amru ashaddu min dhalik. That day, the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day will be much greater that no one will care to look at one another. No one will care. And when the people are raised, after the trumpet is blown, and they are raised, and once they fall out from confusion, from figuring out where they are, every single person will know what they have done. All the people who know that they have done their evil actions, they know they are doomed. The people who know they have done good, they will be at ease. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will keep the people waiting. And Allah in the Quran, He mentions that the Qiyamah is one day. But in the day, in the realm of the Akhirah, the hereafter, it is said in the Quran, مِقْدَارُهُ خَمْسِينَ أَلْفَ سَنَةً That the day over there, Qiyamah is one day. But in the one day in the realm of the Akhirah is 50,000 years. This is why in the Quran, Allah mentions that on the day of Qiyamah, when Allah asks the people, that kam labith, that how many years did you live on this earth? Allah will ask the people, how many years have you lived on this dunya? And the people will say, labithu yawman aw ba'da yawm, that we have only lived in this dunya, in this world, only for one day or part of a day. Because this is how short this life is compared to the hereafter. Compared to the akhirat, what is in front of us, this dunya, this life, this 80 to 60 years that we have, this is only a day or part of a day. So the people, all of us will be gathered on the day of Qiyamah. Every single person will be gathered, every one of us will be there. And the sun, Allah Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith, he mentions that the sun will be 1 mile. The sun will be 1 mile. In Arabic, he used the word meel. It could either mean 1 mile or it can mean the distance of a stick, of a tiny little toothpick. It can mean that distance. So the sun will be this far from each and every single one of us. Each and every single one of us, this is how far the sun will be from us on the day of Qiyamah. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, all of us will be anxious on that day. Everyone will be anxious and everyone will be sweating. Like when we go, and when we go to the doctor, many of us, we do not like going to the doctor because we are afraid of what is going to come out. We always receive some sort of bad news when we go to the doctor. That is why when you go to the doctor, sometimes when you go and when the nurse checks you, they take your pressure, they take it twice because the first time your body is tensed up, you're anxious from waiting in the waiting room. So on the day of Qiyamah, we will all be waiting. We will all be waiting 50,000 years for Allah to start the Hisab. We will be waiting for Allah to start the judgment because everybody knows. Everybody knows what they are going to earn. They just want it to be over with. They wish that they could die 100 times and rather than go through the Hisab. This is how great this day will be. This is how this terrifying and horrifying this day will be. The day where all of humankind, all of Jannat, the angels, everyone will be gathered. Even the animals, Allah in the Quran, He says, وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ. That when the animals, when all the animals, they will be gathered, there will be justice for them on that day as well. So all of us, we will be gathered on the day of Qiyamah, and all of us, we will be naked and we will be barefoot. All of us terrified and worried about what is going to happen to us. And the ones that will be most worried are those who know that they have done evil in this life. They know that they have done wrong. They will look to their left and their right, and they will only see their good and bad deeds. They will only see that which they have put forth before them. So when the people, they see this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shade the seven types of people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shade the seven types, groups of people that we hear in the hadith. Seven types of people on the day of Qiyamah, when the sun will be 1 mile away, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shade seven groups of people. Seven different types of people Allah will shade on the day of Qiyamah. And one of them is Shabun. Shabun nabatha fi ibadatillah, nasha'a fi ibadatillah. That a child, a youngster, who was brought up in the ibadat of Allah. That refers to me and you, my brothers and sisters. All of us who are young here today, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remembering Allah Rabbul Alameen in this gathering, in the young age that we have, when our energy is the most, when we could be outside doing something different, when we could be playing games at the cinemas, doing different things, we are here in the remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, Allah will make us from amongst those who will be under His shade on the day of Qiyamah. So as we are all waiting, there will be some who will be sweating, right? As we are all waiting these 50,000 years for the Qiyamah to start, some people will be sweating, some people will be sweating up to their ankles, some people will be sweating up to their knees, some people will be sweating up to their hips, and others will be sweating and drowning in their own sweat. This is how terrified and how horrendous this day of Qiyamah will be for the people. How horrendous this day of Qiyamah will be, and people will be wondering what will happen. And then Allah will shade the seven groups, seven types of people. But even then, as time is going forward and more time is being passed, because 50,000 years will be passing, then finally Allah then the people will go, the humankind, mankind will start going to the different prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The prophets will go to the different prophets that will be there. The first prophet they will go to is Adam alayhi salatu wassalam. The people will go because everyone is worried. They want the Qiyamah to start. They want the reckoning to start. They want, Ya Allah, start this. We are tired of waiting. Right? It is as if a person who knows what's coming in front of him, he sees it, but he just wants to go in. He just wants it to get it over with. Sometimes when we have exams, we don't care if we studied or if we didn't study. We just want the test. We hate the delay. So like this, we will be on the day of Qiyamah, humankind, mankind will go, they will go to the first prophet ever, they will go to Adam alayhi salatu wassalam. And the people will tell Adam alayhi salam, oh Adam, you please, ask Allah to start Qiyamah. All of the humankind will ask Adam alayhi salatu wassalam, yeah, oh Nabi of Allah, start Qiyamah. Adam alayhi salatu wassalam, he will say, nafsi, I'm only worried about myself, I will only remember about myself. Then فَذَكَّرَ خَطِيئَتَهُ. Then he will remember the thing, his mistake that he did. And he will tell the people, I cannot make dua to Allah. He will tell the people, I cannot make dua to Allah because of the wrong that I have done. I have eaten the fruit which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told me not to do. And because of this, I cannot make this dua to him. Then he will tell the people, go to Prophet Nuh alayhi salatu wassalam. He is the first Nabi, he is the first prophet sent to this earth. He is the first prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Allah made when he was a prophet on this earth. So then the people will go to Nuh alayhi salatu wassalam, and they will ask, Ya Nuh, tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to start the Qiyamah. Then Nuh alayhi salatu wassalam will say, Nafsi, he will say, I'm only worrying about myself. فَذَكَرَ خَطِيئَتَهُ. Then he will remember his wrong that he did when he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about his son. When he told Allah, Ya Allah, huwa min ahli, that his son is from his family. We know that Nuh alayhi salatu wassalam, when Allah was going to send the punishment to drown all the people, Nuh alayhi salatu wassalam kept calling his son, who was a disbeliever. He did not believe in Nuh alayhi salam. But he kept telling him, oh my son, come inside the ship. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, he is not from your family. He is not your family. So this, he remembers this and he considers this to be a fault of his. And he says, because of this fault, I cannot intercede to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he says, go to Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. He is Khalilullah, he is the friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and ask him to intercede for you. Ask him to start the Qiyamah. The mankind all together will go to Prophet, they will go to Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, and they will ask Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, O Nabi of Allah, you are the Khalilullah, you start the Qiyamah. tell the Prophet, tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to start Qiyamah. Then Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu was salam, he will say, no, nafsi, nafsi. He will only be worried about himself. He'll be worried about himself and he will say, he will remember, فَذَكَرَ خَتِيئَتَهُ. He will remember the three lies, three things that he had done, three things that he did wrong and he found himself doing wrong. The first, when he says, إِنِّي سَقِيم, that when he was father, when he was a young boy, his father told him, my son, come with me to the festival so we can worship the idols. He says, إِنِّي سَقِيم, I am not feeling so well. He said this because even though he was healthy, he says, إِنِّي سَقِيم, I am not feeling well, my father, let me stay home. So he considered this a fault, that he did not tell the truth. Then when the people came, we know, when he broke all the idols, and the people came and they asked him, Ibrahim, what happened to all of these idols? He said, the big one did it. The big idol did it. I did not do it. Ask the big one, he did it. Right? So he found this to be something, he did not tell the truth at that moment, and he found this to be a fault in himself. And then finally, the third time, when he was traveling with his wife Sarah, and they were going across one of the countries, one of the towns, and the people they were asking who this woman was that was with him. He said, "This is my sister." When it was actually his wife, but when he said sister, he meant sister in Islam. So he considered this not to say the truth, and because of that, he says, he feels ashamed. How can I ask Allah to start Qiyamah when I have done these three wrong things? So then he says, go to Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. He is Habibullah, he is the one who talks to Allah, he is Kalimullah, he is the one who is talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the one who has been given the Tawrat. Tell him to start the Qiyamah. So the mankind, the human being, everyone will go to Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and they will ask him as well the same thing. And they will get answer of the same thing. Ummati, ummati, fadakara khati'atahu. He will remember his wrong which he did, which was what? When he was a young man, he was trying to solve a dispute and he killed a person by accident. He considered this a fault in himself and he'll be too shy to ask to Allah. Then finally he will tell him to go to Isa. He is Ruhullah. So the people, mankind, will go to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam and they would say, Ya Nabi Allah, you are Ruhullah, you have been formed from the command of Allah. We know that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah told him, Kun fayakun. He was formed from the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why he is Ruhullah. He was formed from the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will give them the final and the same answer. Oh, nafsi, nafsi, I do not even care about my own mother, Maryam. This is such a day where the Anbiya, the Prophets of Allah Rabbul Alameen, will be only caring and only worried about themselves. Then finally, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he will tell the people to go to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and ask him to start the Qiyamah. The people will go to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam will say, Ummati, Ummati. The only Nabi and the only person on that day in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell him, will be saying, Ummati, Ummati, that he will be only considered and caring about his people. What will happen to the people? So mankind will ask Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that tell Allah to start the Qiyamah. This is too much, we cannot take it. We are tired of waiting for this Qiyamah, this dreadful day to pass. It is feeling as if it is not happening. And keep in mind, my brothers and elders and sisters and youngsters, that the people, it will be entire mankind, not only the people who did wrong, they will be more worried, but the believers at the same time as well, because they will feel, yes, they will be at ease, but from the duration, from the 50,000 years of waiting, they themselves will feel as well, when is it going to start, they will be a little bit worried as well, because from all the waiting, that's why the entire mankind will ask Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and intercede before Allah. Then finally he will enter the realm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a place which will only be marked for him, a place in which will only be marked for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the realm of Allah. And he will enter into the realm, and as soon as he enters into the realm of Allah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam will fall into sajda. He will fall into prostration and he will make dua and he will make such a tasbihat in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will teach him at that moment, will put in his heart, and he will make this tasbihat and this praise to Allah Rabbul Alameen in that very moment. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will finally tell him, Irfa ra'sa, sal tu'ta, ishfa tushaffa. That, Ya Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, raise your head and ask whatever we want, you will be given to it, you will be given it. And you intercede and your intercession will be accepted. And this in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Asa rabbuka an yab'athaka rabbuka maqaman mahmuda. that perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise you and give you the maqam al-mahmood. This, my brothers, elders and sisters and youngsters, maqam al-mahmood, this is the intercession in which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will make for the mankind on the Day of Judgment. When everyone will be struggling and everyone will be worrying for when is Qiyamah going to start, Rasulullah will take the initiative and he will fall into sajda and he will make dua. Ya Allah, start the hisab, start Qiyamah, start the Day of Judgment. And then finally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will start the qiyamah. Allah Rabbul Alameen will start the hisab and he will start taking into account every single person on the Day of Judgment. So now we have covered on the Day of Qiyamah how we are getting into it. First we have the blowing of the horn. Then after the first blowing of the horn, everything will be destroyed. And Allah will create everything back. And Allah will prepare the world and everything for the mahshar, for the place of gathering. And that only thing that will be left behind is the ajab al-dhanab, the tailbone of the humankind will be left behind. Then Allah will send down the rain and the bone will become flesh and it will become a body again. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell the angel to blow the horn again. And then the horn is blown and everyone will come back alive. And then everyone will be in the hashar, everyone will be in mahshar, everyone will be in their own spot, naked, barefoot, only worried about themselves. And then Allah, then there will be 50,000 years, and then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will finally make dua to Allah, start the qiyamah, and the qiyamah will begin. Now we are in the hisab. Now we are in the time when the accountancy will be taking place, where every single person, their hisab, what they have done in this dunya will be taken into account. So my brothers and elders, before this even happens, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, He mentions that both Jannah and Jahannam will be brought forth. وَجِيءَ يَوْمَئِذٍ بِجَهَنَّمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ وَأَنَّا لَهُ الذِّكْرَى. That on that day, that Jahannam will be brought forth. Jahannam will be brought forth in front of every single one of us. We will see Jahannam. And the people will realize, the disbelievers and the people who are doomed, they will realize that this is the actual truth. And then Allah says, وَأَنَّا لَهُ الذِّكْرَى. At that time, no realization will help you. This is a lesson for us, that we should not wait until the day of Qiyamah that we wake up, get that wake up call, because then it will be too late. It is very important that we try from this very moment going forth, that Qiyamah is coming. Today we are here to learn about the Qiyamah, but we still need to prepare ourselves. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring Jannah forth as well. Allah will bring Jahannam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring Jahannam to show everyone. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring forth وَأُزْلِفَتِ الْجَنَّةِ. That Jannah will be brought forth as well and the people will see. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will start the hisab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will start the hisab. And we should always make this dua to Allah that He gives us an easy reckoning. And the number one rule before we get into the hisab, this day will be a day of rahmah and a day of justice. La ظُلْمَ الْيَوْمِ. That today, on the Quran Allah says that today, that day of Qiyamah, there will be no injustice done. That everyone will get what they deserve. Meaning that a kuffar, the disbeliever, he will only be punished to that degree of his disbelief. The mu'min, the believer, will be rewarded to that amount of things that he have done. No one will get more, no one will get less. Everyone will get the justice that they deserve. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will start the day of Qiyamah and He will start the hisab. So when He starts the hisab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions in the hadith, when Allah rabbul alameen mentions that He talks about the hisab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He says, لَيْسَ أَحَدٌ يُحَاسَبُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِلَّا هَلَكَ. That every single person who is reckoned for will be asked on the day of judgment, they will be destroyed. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Aisha, she's confused, so she says, doesn't Allah say in the Quran, فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا. Doesn't Rasulullah say that for the believers, they will have a good reckoning, that their reckoning will be very easy, will be very swift. Isn't their account, they're going to be taken very quickly. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, ذَلِكَ الْعَرْضِ عَيْشَةً. That this is just the presentation of the a'mal. This is just your actions being presented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That this is just your actions being presented. That all the little things that we are doing, our salawat that we are doing, the Quran that we recite, the dhikr that we do, the sadaqah that we do, the psalm, all of the good actions that we are doing, these are only being presented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَكِنْ مَنْ نُوْقِشَ فِي حِسَابِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَقَدْ هَلَكَ. That the one who is asked If Allah goes into detail about our actions, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts asking us one by one, then who did you do this action for? What did you do this action for? And he starts questioning us, then this person will have a tough time, then this person will be destroyed. This is why we should always ask Allah Rabbul Alameen for an easy hisab. That, Ya Allah, you give me an easy hisab. Give me a hisab which is very easy. Ya Allah, do not question me about all the my actions that I am doing. Ya Allah, please overlook the actions that I am doing. So this is what happened on the day of Qiyamah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will start, and we will start looking at our actions, and we will present our deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know the questioning will begin. أَوَّلُ مَا يُحَاسَبُ بِهِ الْعَبْدَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. That the first question Allah will ask about the slaves on the day of judgment is about as-salah, your prayers. How did you pray your prayers? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell the angels, the kiram al-kathibin, he will ask them about your prayers. Did you pray the prayers on time? What did you do with the prayers? Did you hold them? Did you hold on to them? Did you let go? How were they? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell them, did you hold on to it or not? And then if there's any discrepancies, if there are any shortcomings in the salah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at how merciful He is. He will tell the angel, look to my slave if he has any nawafil ibadah. Does he have any nafil salah? Does he have any sunnah salah? Does he have any salah that he has prayed out of his own way only for me? If he does, then use this to make up. Use this to make up all the fara'id. This is why it is very important. Sometimes as youngsters, we only want to pray the fard. We only want to pray the two, the four, the three, and the four. And that's it, we want to go home. It is important that we, from a young age, we build a habit of start performing all the salah. Because we do not know. We don't know if our salah is being accepted. We don't know if we are praying our salah the way we should be. This is why always increasing ourselves and an abundance of our nawafil salah, this is something which is very important that we should get into the habit of doing. If we don't make the habit now when we are young, when we become old, the habit will never come. Then Allah, we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us regarding all of the other fara'id as well. He'll ask the same regarding our zakah, our sawm, and our hajj, and all of the other actions that we do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will go according to the same thing. How was your sawm? Did you do them properly? Did you break any? Did you have any nafl to make up? If you did, Allah will give you the pass. So if you have not, Allah will hold you to it. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold you to your actions and He will question you about it. Then finally, my brothers and elders and sisters, then we will go on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask the five questions to every single person on the day of Qiyamah. The first being, how did you spend your life? Then Allah will ask a separate question, how did you spend your youth? This is the two different things, because how did you spend your life? How did you spend the entirety of your life? Then Allah will ask specifically about your youth, because in the youth, this is the time where the ma'asiyah, where the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can happen the most. The youth is the time where we have our energy, where we can go out, we can go and do whatever we want. We can go out and we can do, say, and act, behave however we want. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us, how did you spend your life? How did you spend your youth? Then Allah Rabbul Alameen will ask, how did you earn your income? How did you spend this money that you have earned? And finally, Allah will ask, how much did you act upon your ilm, your knowledge that you earned? Then my brothers and sisters, after all of the hisab is done, after Allah has taken into account of every single person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the angels will come down and they will give the book of deeds. They will give the book of deeds to the people on the right and the left hands. The people of the right hand, they will know that they are entering Jannah. Allah in the Quran, فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ فَيَقُولُ هَا أُمُقْرَأُ كِتَابِيَ. That when he gets it in his right hand, he will tell the people, he will tell his companions, come look into my book, look into the good deeds that I have done. He will be happy. He knows that he is successful. And the person that who is gets it in his left hand, even on that day, the kuffar will try to play games with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They will put their left hand behind their backs and they will put out their right hand, asking from Allah Rabbul Alameen. But on that day, we know there is no escape. There is no escape from Allah's decision on that day. And the angels will skip over them, and when they take out their left hand, they will find their book on their left hand. So on that day, there is no escape from what you will be served on that day. So everyone will be given their deeds, book of deeds, and it will be weighed. And the actions will be weighed, good and evil actions will be weighed. And then the decision will be made whether the person should go to Jannah or the person should go to Jahannam. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will make his shafa'atul kubra. That this is the second intercession, the shafa'atul kubra, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he will intercede for the people on the day of judgment. For those people whose good and evil actions are the same, he will intercede for those people. Those people who have more evil actions than good actions, he will intercede for them. That, Ya Allah, you forgive them. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will do this three or four times. The hadith that is mentioned, He will do this a few times, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let him take those people who have been ordained to go to Jahannam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reverse the decision, and Allah Rabbul Alameen will let these people go into Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let these people go into Jannah until Rasulullah, in the hadith it is mentioned, Illa man habasahumul Quran, except for those people who the Quran doesn't allow, meaning the kuffar and the disbelievers and the mushrikeen, those people who had no iman, who did not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala one bit at all, these people will not be given the shafa'ah. When this is all done and the decision has been made, the people of Jahannam will be thrown into the fire of Jahannam on their stomachs. They will be dragged on their faces and they will be thrown onto the fire of Jahannam. Well, they will abide there forever. They will be there forever and ever and ever. And then finally, when the people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the last stage into going to Jannah, Allah Rabbul Alameen will put before all of us the bridge of Sirat. The pool Sirat has been described. It will be placed over the fire of Jahannam, and it has been described as a bridge which will be sharper than a sword and thinner than a hair. Such a bridge, and the light, there will be no light to cross this road. The light will be your own light, which will come from the a'mal that you have, from the good deeds that you have in this life. The more good deeds you have, the brighter your light will be and the easier it will be for you to walk on the path. But the less actions you have, the dimmer your light. Some people will cross this bridge very quickly. The shuhada, the martyrs, the anbiya, they will cross the bridge very quickly. They will cross the bridge in the speed of light. They will cross the bridge very quickly, within a day's journey, half a day's journey, few hours, minutes, they will cross. But then there will be others who will be on the bridge, very, very, going very slowly, because they were just on the narrow path. Their good and evil actions were just the same. They barely made it to Jannah. Their time, they will spend years and years and hundreds of years trying to cross this bridge, slowly and slowly being careful so they do not fall into the fire of Jahannam. So we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us the ability to cross this bridge very quickly. We make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us this ability to go and to go into Jannah. Because how sad would it be that we go through all of these things and at the final stage we are not able to cross the bridge to go to Jannah. We fall into the fire of Jahannam. So it is important that we try our best to do as much good actions as we can in this life. And finally, my brothers, elders and sisters and youngsters, now we have crossed the bridge of Sirat. We have crossed the bridge of Sirat and now we are ready to enter into paradise. And guess who will be met by? We will be received and will be received by the Malaika. Tahiyyatuhum fiha salam, that the angels will come to us and they will congratulate us. They will tell you congratulations. They will give you salam. They will give you words, warm words of welcoming, telling you, Alhamdulillah, you have come into Jannah. You have made it through that horrific day. Now there will be a day none like that of. And finally, when we enter into paradise, we as Muslims, we believe that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be there and he will give us the Hawd al-Kawthar. In the Quran, Allah says, one of the shortest surahs all of us should know, Inna a'tainaka al-Kawthar, that you have been, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Rasulullah that you have been given the Kawthar, that you have been given the lake. Kawthar is the name of a lake, is a fountain which has beautiful water. This water, it will be whiter than milk and sweeter than honey, and where people will be given to it, because the day of Qiyamah will be very tough, and of a day which will be very warm and hot. So the people will be very thirsty. The people when they're entering Jannah, they will be very, very thirsty. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will greet us. We will go to him. He will embrace us, and he will give each and every one of us a cup full of water from the Hawd of Kawthar, from his fountain, from his lake that he has given in paradise. Something which is he will only be given, not the other prophets of Allah, only him. He will be given, and he will give each and every one of his ummatis, each and every single one of his people, they will be given a cup. They will be given this cup and they will drink from it. Once they drink from this cup of Kawthar, they will never feel thirsty again. And all of the evil things within them, all of the evil things, evil emotions and things that we have within us, enmity, hatred, jealousy, all of these things will leave us. Our surah will change. We will become beautiful. Everything will change. We will, our age, those of us who will be old will become young. Those of us who are young will become old. We'll become older, we'll become beautiful, we'll become handsome. Right? And then we will enter into paradise, and that will be this is the Fawzul Kabir. This is the actual great success. This is the success which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about in the Quran. These are the people who are really successful. When they are able to make it through Qiyamah, now we understand why Allah says. Now a lot of the times we always hear that why is it that going to Jannah is such a big deal? Because the horrific day of Qiyamah is a huge thing. something which will be huge, in which no person, everything, we know so many surahs in the Quran, that every single person will be asked according to his own status. You know, you will not be asked the same thing that the next person. Your account will be different from the next person. Right? So this is why Allah in the Quran, وجوه يومئذ مسفرة ضاحكة مستبشرة, that on this day, the faces will be happy. People will be smiling. People, certain people will be happy. ووجوه يومئذ عليها غبرة ترهقها قطرة, that on this day, there will be people whose faces will be covered in dirt. There's people whose faces will be saddened. Their faces will be black. And these people, أولئك هم الكفرة الفجر, this day will be the people who will be sinful. So on this day, my brothers, elders and sisters and youngsters, this day will be a horrific day. And when we make it into Jannah, inshaAllah, to the rahmat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we will experience true happiness and we will experience the eternal happiness. So this concludes the entire sequence of what will happen on the day of judgment. Just to recap, after all the signs have happened, we know the first trumpet will be blown. After that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will start forming the earth and everything will decay except for the tailbone, and Allah will send down rain and the flesh and everything will come back, and then Allah Rabbul Alameen will tell the angel to blow the horn again, and finally everyone will come awake and we will be in the mahshad, we will be in the plain land where all of us will be gathered, the angels, the jinns, the human beings, that even the animals will be gathered on that day, and we'll be waiting for the hisab to happen, and everyone will be horrified, and the sun will be a mile away, and Allah will give his shade to whomever he wants, the seven groups of people. Then finally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell the people will go to the anbiya, and they will tell the anbiya to tell Allah to start qiyamah, and finally Rasulullah will start, and then the hisab will take place. After the hisab, people will cross the bridge, and inshallah when we cross the bridge, we will be met by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who will give us water from the Haud of Kawthar, and then we will enjoy for the rest of eternity. So these are the things I hope and I pray that all of us learn something and increase our knowledge in the akhirat. Many of us, we hear about these things, but we do not know in detail what is going to happen. And we should not just only stop there. And Rasulullah in the hadith, if he says, the one who asanahu an yanzura ila yawm al-qiyamah, the one who is happy and he wants to learn more about qiyamah, he should read these three surahs. Idha shamsu kuwirat, idha samaa shaqqat, wa idha samaa fatarat. If we read these three surahs with the translation and the easy tafsirs that are available in English today, especially all of us, we should try our best. Pick up the Quran. We should not only wait for the speakers to feed us this knowledge. We should have the desire to go out and learn more. These programs that we have, my brothers, elders and sisters, and especially youngsters, these programs that we have should create a zeal for us to go out and learn more about the topics that are being discussed. Because if we just come to the program, we listen to it, by, I can guarantee you, 2 months, 3 months, all the information that we have learned will go out the window. It is important that we go back and forth and we try to learn more about this topic at hand. And at the end of the day, my brothers, elders and sisters, whatever that has been mentioned, this has all been mentioned in the light of the Quran and Hadith. We should not delve so much, so deep into certain things, that how will this be? How will Allah do this? How will Allah make the earth? How will Allah make us strong? Things like that. When we go to two extremes of these things, they will take us away from the straight path. We should just go on the Zahiri. Whatever Rasulullah and Allah mentions in the Quran and the Hadith, we should just stick to that, and we should not go so much into it. So my brothers, elders and sisters, I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us ease on the day of Qiyamah, when there will be a horrifying day. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us ease on that day. And I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those people who will be under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day when there will be no shade except His. Wa sallallahu ta'ala ala khayri khalqihi Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in wa akhiru da'wan alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Allowed, but only through the permission of Allah. It is not such that they become a hafiz and now I have guaranteed. If Allah says you can, then you can. If Allah says no, then no. And remember, my brothers, elders and sisters and youngsters, it's the hufaz and the ulama, the hafiz and the scholars who are what? They act upon their knowledge, they act upon the Quran that they have memorized. Not just this by, they just know it by heart and that is it. They're living a life which is a contrary to the Quran. They have to act upon it as well. This is another condition.
Our next question is, if hijabs are meant for covering your hair, is it okay for wrapping it in a way where only your hair is covered?
Hijab is not, sometimes we have misunderstanding of what hijab is. Hijab is not only just a scarf that we wrap around our hair, our heads, but hijab is actual concept. It's an ideology, it's an understanding that hijab is me trying to conceal myself in such a way that my beauty is not showing, that my figure is not showing. It is not just something that only my hair is covered and now I can wear any type of fitted clothing so my everything is shown. Hijab is something which I need to cover my entire body so my figure and everything is shown for all the ghayr mahrams, all those people who are not my mahram, who are not related to me. I cannot show my figure or my hair. So just simply covering the hair, this is a misconception that is happening within the ummah. They just believe that I can cover my hair and I can do whatever, dress however I want. This is a misconception. This is one of the fitnas of the ummah. We need to start going back to the original where we hijab is a covering, that we cover everything, our now our hair, but also our physical shape. So it's better that women that we try to adopt the full hijab, not just part.
The next question is, if a person is 50% good and 50% bad, will he go to hell? First or heaven?
A person who is like that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be up to his judgment what he will do. But the scholars, they mentioned that this type of people, Rasulullah, when I mentioned that Rasulullah will give the shafa'atul kubra, will he will be allowed to give people intercession. This is one of the groups of the people he will be interceding for. Those people who good and evil actions are the same, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be able to intercede for these type of people and he will be able to take them into Jannah.
Next question is, on the day of Qiyamah, will there be a war with Muslims against
the
Dajjal and the Jews?
This not on the day of Qiyamah. This has been, I believe, mentioned before, the signs of the day of Qiyamah. When the Dajjal is there, his army, and the army of Isa alayhi salam and Mahdi alayhi salam, their armies will go at it. This will be one of the signs of Qiyamah. So it will now happen on the day of judgment. The day of judgment is the day of Hisab, where everything will be taken into account. No more action on that day.
The next question is, on the day of Qiyamah, will Yajju and Majju come out of the
wall? This is another question which is before Qiyamah, right? I believe this was probably discussed before, that this is one of the things that will happen before the day of Qiyamah happens. These are the signs, Yajju and Majju, not on the day of Qiyamah.
The next question is, if I leave the house after putting on perfume, do I have to make fard ghusl before praying?
No, you do not have to make fard ghusl. Fard ghusl only happens when you are in Hadath al-Akbar, when you are in a junub state where you have relations with your spouse or you have a wet dream, then that time you have to make ghusl. When you put on perfume, you do not need to make ghusl.
The next question is, will the rest of Allah's creations be destroyed? Angels, jinns, and rasuls?
No, rasuls are human beings. Angels are the makhluk of Allah, and jinns are the makhluk of Allah. And the like angels, they will always be there. They'll be doing the duties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever Allah tells them. The angel, the jinnat and the human mankind, prophets are part of mankind, so they will be in Jannah or Jahannam. Jinnat, we know they're good and also bad jinns. So they themselves will also be given the hisab. So that day, the good jinns will go into Jannah and the evil ones will go into Jahannam. Only thing that will be destroyed and perished are the animals. The animals, after their judgment is done, they will perish and they will become dust.
The last question is, if a Christian person transfers to a Muslim, will they still go to heaven?
Yes, if a Christian person becomes a Muslim. Yeah, so the Christian person becomes a Muslim, then he will, yes, when Islam erases everything that is before that. So if your person was disbeliever, then he becomes a Muslim, accepts Islam and accepts Allah, then yes, he will be permitted to paradise.
The next question is, will what is the name of the place we get sent to for Day of Judgment, and what is the name of the bridge over Jahannam that we walk over?
The place that we will be, it was the Mahshar, is called the place of gathering. Mahshar means place of gathering, so we will all be there. And the place that we will be, the bridge that we place is called the Sirat. Sirat literally means path. So this is the path that we place over the Jahannam for us to enter Jahannam.
Will a person be able to pray in those 50,000 years?
No, that day will be a day of torment and a day where you cannot do any more actions. You will just be standing, looking around, waiting for the Qiyamah to start.
Thank you.